Right now, in my class back home, we've built this weird thing, the Southern History Database. And what this is we've asked our students to go in, and everybody was assigned a decade. Sorry, I can't. I'm just going to do this and then be quiet. Go ahead. I don't care. Okay, going down to Charlottesville, thinking about it. Okay, and now please sort these by date. And right now, I'm the object of much cursing back in Charlottesville because of this assignment that I've given us. So here what we've done is that I told people to make a 20 events they were responsible for a time and place in the South. And they scoured all the primary records and the special collections in the library and read all these newspapers just like Bob Dylan did back in 1960. I'm sure they have the same memory of it, he will. And that they write all these things, and it's able to map over 600 laws in this case that were passed in the South. And the inspiration for this is Wikipedia. But wouldn't it be cool, I thought, if this work that we all do in our classes, where people write these things, and we spend all this time reading the papers and making comments on it, and they go, yeah, great. Wouldn't it be great if that work was collaborative and cumulative? And so I made the students do this. and what it is, by two-thirds of the way of the semester, we built this, and then they wrote their final papers based on all the work that they had done together, kind of like the science is collaborative. This semester is even more crazy because now we have these events. Now they have to go out and find 10 episodes, any narratives, nano-history, I'm thinking of it, history that you might be able to read on a cell phone. How would you write history if you could only write it in 1,200-word pieces? That you still had to be true to the primary source and to narrative coherence and to the secondary source. And one of the things that this does, I won't take the time to show you, but it maps it. And so it instantly plots all this on a map. You can look at the map and say, oh, I'm interested in crime. I see that this county had a lot. I have no idea what county that is, but I see it's dark. Click on it. Then that expands into all the database. So and this spring, six liberal arts colleges from around the country are adopting it for themselves. We've just done the American South, but they're going to be adding New England and parts of the West. And we'll have a national database of all these different new kinds of history that we can plot and see different kinds of patterns in that we never have before. I don't even have to raise a grant to pay for it. So what does this brief but varied journey through these different kinds of things tell us? First, that the form and substance of the humanities are deeply related. Changing the form of the history we relate to include some of the perspectives we touched on tonight changes both the texture of the story and its very point. I have to admit, I don't know how you're supposed to write history out of all of this. I did write a book out of the Valley Project about the coming and the first half of the Civil War. Now I've got to write the second half, apparently, since I stopped in the middle. But it's not exactly clear, how do I go about writing the history of freedom when what we have are these little mosaics, these little tiny pieces of historical experience? How do we weave this into a meaningful pattern so that it's not just like a database, but rather something that people turn to history for, the coherence and the force of narrative? Selection is still necessary, but the selectivity will be based on a broader, more variegated, and more open foundation. It will take us a while to figure out how to write history, or to project it, or to narrate it, or to dramatize it from these sources, but I think it will happen, and it will be interesting to see what the answer is. Changing the basis of our approach to the vast archives of the humanities throws our ideas about the humanities into productive tension. Where else, other than at this symposium, are people from such a wide array of humanities coming together to talk about common challenges and problems? Okay? It's not a common thing for people who are interested in the entire range of things that all the computer science can do and an entire range of the humanities. And one thing that's great about it is we're trying to make our lives harder. We know how to write books. My students say, Mr. Ayers, I got into college because I know how to write a paper. I don't know how to write a database entry. Okay, there's not one. There's not a model. What? Show me one. I said, there's not any. You've got to figure it out yourself. I don't like that. I want an A. I'm sorry. We've got to figure it out ourselves. But that what we're doing is not unlike that. Trying to write this in any other form is going to be much that same exercise and that same anxiety projected. Exposing my language-based discipline of history to the visual, the graphic, and the dynamic throws it off balance. And that's exactly what the humanities need to do. force themselves onto foreign territory, force themselves to pick up new tools, and let themselves make some new friends along the way. And that's what I look forward to doing over the course of this weekend.